February 25.
Hindi ko po alam.
Kick-off ng company. So for me po, normal day lang po for others.
Yung about po to sa, ano, sa martial law?
People's Power.
People's Power Revolution.
Anniversary na...
EDSA Revolution.
EDSA People Power Revolution was a product of many events, but the most crucial na nababasa natin online, sa mga online materials at sa mga libro, ay yung mga events na nangyari from February 22 to 25, 1986. Gusto nila ng pagbabago sa loob, na, hindi lamang sa loob ng institusyon ng military, kundi sa governance ng rehiming Marcos. No? Kasama ni Enrile dito si Gringo Honasan, at eventually nakasama niya si General Fidel V. Ramos. So, nagkaroon sila ng pagplaplano ng isang coup, February 22. Kaya lang nakarating itong balita na ito sa Malacanang. Enrile made phone calls to appeal to the Filipino people and the leaders of the civil society. We need support, parang ganon. Isa sa mga panawagan niya kay Jaime Cardinal Sin. Eventually, by that day, February 22, nanawagan si Jaime Cardinal Sin sa Filipino people through Radio Veritas na suportahan natin itong mga kaibigan natin na nandito. Kaibigan natin sila, mga sa oposisyon sa loob ng Camp Aguinaldo.
This is Cardinal Sin speaking to the people, especially in Metro Manila. I am indeed concerned about the situation of Minister Enrile and General Ramos. I am calling our people to support our two good friends at the camp.
The Cardinal urged the country to unite at the long stretch of Epifanio de los Santos Avenue, known today as EDSA.
If any of you could be around at Camp Aguinaldo to show your solidarity and your support in this very crucial period, when our two good friends have shown their idealism, I would be very happy if you could support them now.
So consciously, people come in droves, no, in thousands, in millions, and that led to the People Power One Revolution.
By that time also, February 23, bumalik na si Cory sa Manila. And there was mounting international pressure against the Marcos regime already at that time. For example, the White House already was questioning the legitimacy of the Marcos administration because of all of this that's happening.
So eventually, it was a defection. It's the loss of confidence. It's the loss of legitimacy that led to the downfall of the Marcos government. And those iconic images of nuns, kneeling in front of a tank, offering flowers and praying the rosary, jumping Fidel Ramos, was also an iconic image.
Nagkaroon ng press con uli si Marcos. So ito yung infamous na press con.
We are massing civilians near our troops and we cannot keep on withdrawing. They asked us to withdraw yesterday. When I talked to Mr. Enrile, he said, you talk to you, we will do a little.
My order is to disperse.
We cannot withdraw all the time, Mr. President.
Without shooting them. No, hold on. You disperse the crowd without shooting them.
So February 25, famous dahil may dalawang oath-taking na nangyari. Oath-taking ceremony sa Club Filipino sa San Juan. Cory Aquino and yung kanyang katandem sa Unido, si Doy Laurel, Salvador Laurel, ay took an oath as President and Vice President of the Republic. And then, shortly after, na-televised din yung oath-taking naman ni Marcos. Although wala doon si Arturo Talentino, but they were sworn in as president and vice president. Pero alam na within Marcos circle sa loob ng Malacanang that it was just saving face, the oath-taking. No? US has already decided also on their part to withdraw support from the Marcos.
Because of that, no, we could see at the last day that Marcos fled, no, to Hawaii, which is a sign of surrender, a sign of yielding, not to the will of the people, to the triumph of people power.
And then there were already protesters entering, nagkaroon ng forced entry sa loob ng Malacanang.
Nalaman ko po siya nung preschool or LM ako.
History.
E-box lang din dati nung
elementary?
Basic knowledge from school, elementary, high school.
Kasi naka-red mark siya sa calendar. So, based on me, halos karamihan ng naka-red mark is walang pasok.
And the social media na din.
We all know naman na nagkaroon ng revolution that time dahil sa government na meron tayo.
Nare-recall ko lang yung parang event na nangyari doon is a lot of people unite and then they prayed.
Yung mga naganap sa martial law and nag-ano po sila, nag-power walk.
Yung pagkakaisa po ng mamamayan since it's a revolution po.
It aims to remind us na kung paano lumaban yung bawat Pilipino na magkaroon ng maayos na gobyerno.
Well, I think the greatest challenge should be having to risk their lives, having to face and confront the military artilleries and the military firepower of the Marcos regime.
Seeing the guns in front of them, seeing the military tanks that was deployed to shoot anytime, pero andyan pa rin yung matibay na human barricade.
They let their faith operates, to be able to resist and to be able to overcome such form of challenge in a way. And having to rely on their own reasoning, their own principle, that only by a non-aggressive method that we could achieve liberty, freedom, and justice, and truth.
Pag nadidinig ko EDSA Revolution, ang pumapasok sa isip ko lagi si Cory Aquino. And parang movement siya against Marcos.
Parang more on dilawan.
Yun yung time na like nagkaisa yung tao.
Nagsama-sama po ang Pilipino para matumba ang isang dictatorship.
Again, yung pagkakaisa ng mga tao since they are fighting for parang peace.
Siguro Robinson's Galleria. So yun. Kasi doon ginanap.
Magigiting na mga Pilipino na lumalaban.
Ikaw. Yung pagkakaisa ng mga tao, ayun, and democracy na rin.
People who fought for our future generation.
Unity to get parang makuha natin what is right and what is kailangan ng mga taong bayan.
Well, it is a historical moment. It's a constitutional moment, no? It's a political revolution, a democratic revolution that's successful, that has attempted to revive and resuscitate, the deepening or strengthening of our democratic institutions and democratic processes. So I think EDSA People Power have brought democracy to its purest level.
So provisional government, at ni-recognize din to ng United States, nagkaroon ng provisional government, it's such a time na magkaroon ka ng newly instituted functioning government. Kasi nanggagaling sila Corazon Aquino sa isang gobyerno na isang forma ng diktadurya. Yung democratic institutions were all dismantled. So it was the task of this provisional government led by Corazon Aquino and her political circle to re-establish the democratic institutions.
Like the creation of the Commission on Human Rights, the creation of the Philippine Commission on Good Government, and the invalidation and the revocation of that Marcos Decrees, that more or less provided the backbone and the catalyst for democratization.
There were safeguards na para hindi abusuhin ng mga leader natin yung pagdedeklara ng martial law. Mahirap mag-declare ng martial law under the 1987 Constitution as opposed to the 1935 Constitution. Ang daming mga karapatan ang nawala during the time of the martial law period. For example, freedom of speech and assembly was curtailed, hindi ba? Even when we talk about human rights, we also talk about the right to have a decent livelihood and living.
The focus of People Power One, now to be able to restore, it's not really a revolutionary movement, it's a restorative movement.
In fact, the right to have a decent livelihood struggled pa rin even in the post-EDSA People Power Revolution context. Kasi kung titingnan nyo yung statistics, it took 21 years for the Philippine economy to recover. Panahon na lang ni Gloria Macapagal yun na naka-recover.
So we never really have such democratic gifts or democratic blessings that we enjoy the day after no People Power won.
It inspired me na magkaroon ng mag-broaden yung knowledge ko when it comes to our history, governance, and of course, the future leaders ng ating country.
Make you think about things na good for you and for the others, especially for your country po. Siguro yung pagiging Pilipino natin, mahalaga kasi yun na kapag sobra na yung government, meron tayong voice.
Meron tayong sariling power kahit mag-isa lang tayo or by group, meron tayong kakayahan.
Nabibigyan pa akong hope na pwede po magtulong-tulong ang tao at magkaisa.
The EDSA People Power on Revolution was triggered, no, and sparked by the assassination of Ninoy on August 21, 1983. So tama na, sobra na, palitan na. Hindi ka nag-iisa were the narratives, no, of the Filipinos back then. The factor for social eruption or social volcano in which they have to go and you have to fight what they perceive as abusive or kleptocratic government, no? And I think the inspiration come from all sectors of society, no, from the church, no, which has implored and exhorted its Catholic flocks and even other religion, no, to go to EDSA.
Even in the 1980s, kahit tapos na yung batas militar, masugid pa rin yung pag-organize sa mga mass organizations, yung mga aktivista, hindi ba, na yung mga organisasyon ng mga aktivista that were forced to be driven underground, like Kabataang Makabayan for the youth sector, so on and so forth, because of the dictatorship, lumalawak yung kanilang kasapian, yung pag-organize.
Because they were motivated and they were somehow inspired, no, by the message that the time has come for them to change the government.
So maraming mga factors depending on the class and the type of groups in the society on why they chose to participate in the EDSA People Power Revolution.
If EDSA People Power never happened, some things might never be the way it was na as of today po.
So tingin ko hindi tayo makakalaya sa dictatorial government.
Kung walang kahilos eh, so parang ganun at ganun na lang din yung mangyayari.
Siguro kung hindi nangyari kasi yun, parang people, ano, maybe may get used to it.
Actually, kung hindi na nangyari yung EDSA, yes, mas maganda ang Pilipinas ngayon kung hindi natuloy yun. Kasi for what reason? Marcos is a good leader.
I think eventually a revolution was bound to happen. Kung hindi man nangyari itong mga ito, for example, I think eventually there would be an organic revolution that would be organized. Because yung itong EDSA People Power Revolution, kailangan natin tandaan na hindi lang to tungkol doon sa mga big names sa side ng opposition. I'm not saying na wala silang crucial part sa revolution. They had crucial roles in the revolution. But that revolution won't be successful if not for the organic participation of the people.
Nagdi-disagree na sila for just what happened, na parang sa mga ano, tumakbong mga mayor or mga president like Cory Aquino, Aquino and Noynoy Aquino, they show us na parang parang lalong lumugmok ang Pilipinas.
Yes, kasi kagaya nga po ng nangyayari ngayon, yung mga tao is pinag-uusapan pa rin po and sinasalabrate pa rin po ang EDSA People Power. Ako, personally, we take that as event, di ba? So parang mahalaga pa din yun na alalahanin natin na yung Pilipinas, ito, nakalaya siya sa ganitong uri ng government.
I think yes, lalo na ngayon na sobrang open na natin sa social media in terms of voicing out our opinions with regards to the government that we have in our country. So, sa tingin ko sobrang aware na ng bawat Pilipino, even the youths nowadays.
Karamihan siguro alam pa rin po yun at nakoconsider pa rin po yun sa ano, na pag-iisipan pa rin po.
I think po wala na po. Kasi ang iniisip na lang po ng mga Pilipino ay isang rest day na lang po para sa ano, katrabahuan natin, para sa mga schools.
Sobrang matatalino na yung mga tao sa pagpuna ng mga mali sa gobyerno, sa mga nangyayari sa kapaligiran natin.
Meron tayong institutionalized state-level commemoration ng EDSA People Power Revolution No, nirerecognize yan ang Malacanang ng national government. Meron tayong National Historical Commission of the Philippines na nangunguna sa commemoration ng EDSA People Power Revolution.
The usual way of commemorating or remembering EDSA 1 is by way of a special non-working holiday, right? But there have been a lot of markers and a lot of cornerstones that were built or erected, established, no, in commemoration of People Power 1. No, of course, you have the EDSA Shrine, no, in somewhere in Ortigas, no, the Lady of EDSA. And of course, you have the Bantayog ng mga Bayani in Quezon Avenue, I think, no, where you have the Wall of Heroes, again, to commemorate those people who fought the martial law and people going to EDSA before, no. But right now, we have seen that fading or slowly disappearing, no. And I think for some schools, no, they commemorate People Power 1 by way of a cultural presentation, no, or by way of maybe a musical presentation and the like, no. Yeah, Paul, that's one of the challenges right now, no, on how the millennials and Generation Z can actually remember and reminisce, no, People Power 1, because they're not actually born in 1986, no. So it's the 37th year of EDSA. That's why it's very important, it's very crucial, no, that, again, going back to the social institution, no, that the family, the government, the church, and the media should always instill a heightened level of awareness and consciousness as part of civic education, as a part of civic responsibility. The media, the television, social media, or the radio, should propagate and should produce a lot of learning content, no, about People Power 1. I think they could exemplify the spirit of EDSA and the legacy of EDSA by staying aware and vigilant of their rights and freedoms, to be on guard on what's happening around us, and to be aware of our social political issues, to keep them with eyes open and with enlightened mind and enlightened ears in a way.
Ang dami from the youth sector na nag-initiate to digitize, for example, and popularize, for example, important sources, video materials, archival documents relating to the martial law period and EDSA People Power Revolution. Ang daming online archives bigla, di ba, nagsulputan. We just have to consolidate them and then further popularize them, use them inside the classrooms.
No, we should find one opportune time in which we're going to celebrate again. We're going to again revive the spirit of EDSA by way of emphasizing the lessons and the messages and the teachings that we have imbibed.
You see many of our Filipino youth actively participating in online discourse. Kahit patrols yung kalaban, yung ka-argumento nila sa social media. Hindi lang online participation, may mga mass demonstrations pa, ang daming kabataan sumasama dyan. So makikita mo doon yung kanilang, they are aware of the issues and they are aware that this is important kasi pinaglaban to.
That's why we have to rely only on political facts. We only have to depend on factual observations without having to exaggerate or without having to infuse our political affiliation or political color. So social media is indeed a gigantic challenge, no, for the young of today on how to appreciate People Power 1.
It makes it easier for us to digitize everything, di ba? But it's also used as a propaganda in order, for example, to dispute the value of EDSA People Power Revolution. Yun yung isang challenge doon. So, andyan yung labanan na ginagamit yung fake news for political purposes. And in the process, nadidistort yung consciousness ng netizens natin.
They are bombarded with information. No? But they don't know how to crystallize and how to purify and how to clarify the information. No? They don't know how to filter and how to, I mean, provide factuality and authenticity to the information that they are getting.
Most likely, yung mga students ko, if not all of them, have this consciousness kung ano yung EDSA People Power Revolution, ano yung naging epekto ng dictatorship sa Pilipinas. And it's very difficult to spot online disinformation, historical distortions online, kasi sobrang credible nung pagkakagawa ng video materials. It's very brief, it's attention grabbing, for example.
In my case, no, I usually conduct no musical or theatrical presentation about People Power One, no, the evolution of the last 3 decades of the Philippines from martial law to People Power Two. From there, they could research on the narratives of what happened during martial law. That's one area. Now, what happened in People Power One? What happened in People Power Two? No, in that way, I think could be effective form, no, in educating and inspiring the young people of today to remember and relive the legacy and spirit of EDSA.
Siguro yung pag-share posts, yung mga informative posts about doon. Siguro makakatulong yun to share din doon sa mga kabataan na nakikita na ito yung nangyari dito and mahalaga to.
So, pag nakapagbigay tayo ng awareness sa mga ganitong kasaysayan nga, doon natin mapapakita na importante yung mga ganitong piraso ng mga kasaysayan.
To spread more details about Marcos.
I will voice out my opinion and standpoint with regards to our government.
Parang wag natin kalimutan kung anong nasa history natin. Parang always natin alalahanin kasi kung wala po sila or hindi po nangyari yung isang event na yun or that specific event, wala po tayo sa place natin as of today.
Palagi po titingnan look back po dun sa nangyari sa EDSA Revolution. At dapat isa sa puso ko po since ang mga kapwa Pilipino ko po dati ay pinaglaban ang freedom po ng Philippines.
One click away lang, napakadali ng paalala sa mga bata or sa mga kahit matatanda na oh, na we did this and we still have the power to do this if may mangyari pang ganun.
Kung i-describe ko in one word ang EDSA People Power Revolution, the word would be democratic.
If I have to describe People Power One in one word, democracy.
The major events that I mentioned in the brief discussion of EDSA People Power Revolution, these were trigger points. Wala kang organic response. Kahit pa may trigger point ka, yung organic response, hindi yan magiging effective kung wala sa mga tao yung consciousness na kailangan na ng pagbabago. These trigger point events really touched on the sentiments of the Filipino people that they wanted drastic and genuine social change.
If you do not have democracy, then what life is all about? We could be an affluent society, an affluent country, but without democracy, No, then you're finally awarding a death knell, no, even to society. So we breathe and live with democracy. And usually when we talk of democracy, it's a procedural aspect of democracy that we're fighting for. We may not be economically progressive or economically developed, but we should not give up on democracy because it's what really keeps us moving forward.